thank you very much for giving me the chance to talk about our recent book. So this book is actually, I'm sorry, man, it's not a survey of machine learning or a survey of computer vision, but it's actually a survey of some of the latest work in computer vision using geometrical framework. So what are some of the latest work in computer vision, but it's now related to deep learning, which is still surviving the deep learning onslaught. So we are talking about covariance matrix, covariance operators in machine learning and pattern recognition, particularly in computer vision. And the use of covariance matrices and covariance operators. We're talking about infinite dimensional covariance operators here as a part of the paper representation. So, okay, so I'm going to acknowledge my collaborators, Marco Sanbiagio and Vittorio Moreno, who is actually officially a professor here at the University of Verona, even though he works at IIT in Genova. And covariance matrix is that's been like a series of work done here in Verona by the group of Marco Pispani and Mauro Spera. I'm not sure if you're here. Mauro Spera. Okay, yeah, not here. So the motivation for this is similar to talk about the symmetric positive W STD matrices. So these actually have found a lot of applications. Basically, so of course we have been studying a lot in mathematics and in statistics, but they actually have a lot of applications in numerous different fields. In brain imaging, in diffusion tensor imaging, a lot of applications in computer vision, in object detection, in visual recognition, and a lot more. Also in radar signal processing and some forms in machine learning. So they have a lot of applications. A lot of the work actually was actually motivated by applications actually from brain imaging and computer vision. So what I would like to talk about today is actually I will give a summary of the kind of the covariance matrices, the use of covariance matrices as a form of data representation in computer vision. And so this would actually use a lot of the kind of the geometry of SVD matrices. And then we'll talk about Gaussian methods and covariance matrices. And then in the second part of the talk, I will talk about covariance operators, which is the infinite dimensional or the nonlinear generalization of covariance matrices. So these are more powerful than covariance matrices because they are nonlinear and they can be infinite dimensional, so they are much richer as part of the representation. At the same time, they are much more computationally heavy. So maybe one can use quantum computing for this purpose, for speeding up the computational process. Okay. So this is a data representation approach in computer vision for using covariance matrices for representing images. So it was something like about 10 years ago, people actually used covariance matrices for representing. If we have an image, and each pixel, if we extract like a set of feature vectors, if we have like intensity colors and different filter responses, then we can represent the each image which gives rise to a data matrix X. No question. Can I talk like this without a phone? So each image gives rise to a data matrix X, where size n by n, where n is the number of pixels and n is the number of features of each pixel. So for each data matrix, if we have data matrix, we can compute a mean vector of this data matrix, and we can compute a covariance matrix of the data matrix. So these covariance matrix is used as a representation for the image. So for example, the example of image features can be some very simple features like intensity of the red colors, so green color, blue color, and different gradients of the color channels. So this is like one very simple example. So this one is actually a covariance matrix of size n by n of the image. Of course, now in general, like, people don't use like kind of represent like a whole image by this covariance matrix. So actually, kind of like some kind of like different regions of the image by one covariance matrix. So now the motivation from the computer vision perspective is actually very. The covariance matrix, each covariance matrix kind of encodes linear correlations between different image features, and they are actually very flexible because they allow the fusion of multiple different features. You can use like colors, the intensity, and the gradients, and so on. And also, specifically, we have also used convolutional features as well. And they are pretty complex because if you have like a very large image, then you can represent the image by a pretty small covariance matrix. Now this is no longer true in the infinite dimensional setting, but in the finite dimensional setting it is the case, and it's robust to noise. Because when we carry out this kind of like summation process, we cannot get up a lot of the noise, actually kind of get smooth out. So it actually has been used actually a lot in computer vision, and it has been, so before we're talking about like two-dimensional images, but you can actually generalize it to the representation of videos. So when we input features, we encode temporal information, and then it can be used for representing three-point clouds and 3D shapes. So when we actually use geometric features like curvature and surface on the vectors. Am I talking too fast? So now when we talk about covariance matrices, of course, that's like a, essentially there's like a probability measure behind to talk about covariance matrices. So this is one interpretation of this approach. It's not an interpretation because actually the method works without interpretation, but this is one way to view it. Actually, if we represent an image by covariance matrix, then it is essentially equivalent to representing the image by the Gaussian probability measure. And the features extracted as random observations of this of an n-dimensional random vector with probability with the Gaussian probability density being low. So we have like a random vector, then we can compute the mean vector, the covariance matrix. And in the case of the covariance matrix is being kind of measured the correlation between the different features. And we have the features in I and xj, and we see the covariance between the xi and xj, and the correlation is just the normalized, covariance coefficient. So basically, this is like a motivation for using this covariance matrix for using to capture the correlation between the different image features. And so in the case, if the probability measure is the Gaussian density in Rn, then of course, if that is completely determined by the mean and the covariance matrix, and if the mean is equal to zero, then rho is completely determined by the covariance matrix C. So if we represent the image by a Gaussian probability measure, then basically the image can be determined by the covariance matrix. And so if we have a data matrix X, which is whose columns are ID observation subtle according to row, then it can be shown that mu X and Cx are the maximum likelihood estimates of mu and C. And so of course it's actually this Cx here is actually not unbiased. It's actually a biased estimate because the expectation is actually not equal to C itself. So sometimes, so actually it's pretty common people to use like the unbiased estimate of C as well. We have to replace this one over n by one over n minus one. So the expectation of this will be equal to C. So in general, we have to use the regularization in practice because the empirical covariance matrices are not only going to be positive definite, even though in the if C is a positive definite, and it can be unconditional as well. So in general, people actually use a regularization. So with the simplest form, it's called diagonal loading, where we just add like a factor gamma I, where gamma is greater than zero. So this is always positive definite and well conditioned. And so it's very easy to generalize into the three-dimensional setting. And it's an example of a general estimator in statistics, which is called shrinkage estimators. So it has this form of where kind of have like we have like CX, like this like 1 minus 0, and 4 over 0, and 1. So you can kind of shrink the eigenvalues to those eigenvalues going to the eigenvalue matrix. Okay, so that is the covariance matrix representation in computer vision of representing images by covariance matrices. So if we want to do things like classification and clustering and regression and so on, we need a notion of distance and similarity measures between images. So if we use this representation, it means that we need to compare covariance matrices. If regularized properly, they are SPD matrices. So basically, we want to be able to compare SPD matrices. So if we're talking about the geometry of SPD matrices, now there are many different ways for computing the distances between the SPD matrices. There are the simplest way, of course, is the equivalent metric, but it is not the in general, it's not, it's very simple to use it, it's very fast to compute, but it's not, it tends to be suboptimal. And there are other approaches as well. So the first one is actually the view of this, the set of MIM SPD matrices as a Riemannian manifold. So two of the most common metrics on this view are the affine variant Riemannian metric and the log Riemannian metric. And then also that's also the view of the SPD, the set of SPD matrices as a mixed form, so when we have the log determinant divergences. So this actually, this the third view is actually a very general view, it's actually the kind of the most general view. But I'm going to talk about the, first few views, I just mentioned the third view briefly. So the first one, because the Euclidean matrix, so we just compute the distance, the inner product, and the norm of the matrix using the probabilistic inner product and the probabilistic norm, which is just the product A and B, which is A and B. So this one, of course, is very simple, the norm squared, simple the summation of all the entries of AR, what happens to all of this. But it's actually a very simple way to view it because it just like basically just factorizes the matrix A and just computing the rank of the number edges and the number of the vectorization of A and so on. So it doesn't take into account the structure of the matrix A as a positive as an SPD matrix because it's essentially just the matrix is just vectors. So it's not intrinsic to C plus plus M. So the set of SPD matrix is actually it's not a vector space because we add if we add the SPD matrix, of course, we can get an SPD matrix. And if we subtract them, the subtraction may not lie in the set anymore, and it's not closed under a scalar multiplication. It's only closed under positive scalar multiplication. So it's a convex form. So it's not. So it's actually, it has a very special structure, and basically the matrix doesn't take into account this structure. And also may lead to something called the Schrödinger effect. This actually has to do with brain imaging. So in this case, actually the middle of the set of SPD matrices may have like a larger determinant than the component matrices. And it's not under this matrix, the set of SPD matrices it's an incomplete matrix space because we have Gaussian sequences which will be obtained from a theoretic algorithm that may not converge. So it can be suboptimal in practical application. It can be used because it's actually very fast, but it's said to be suboptimal. So that's why people have been, one thing about it is because it's like a rotational invariance of the order invariance. So if we transform the matrix A by, DAD transpose, DBD transpose, where D is an orthogonal matrix and the distance remains the same, so it's orthogonally invariant and it translates the rotation invariance in the setting of covariance matrix because we transpose the data by the transformation D, then the covariance matrix is transformed by CSD transpose. So this means that it's actually it's kind of like rotation invariance. So this is like the only the kind of the nice invariance property that is satisfied. But other than that, it's actually not. It has some undesirable properties. So that's why people have considered other ways of measuring distances between SPD matrices. So the first one is the view of the set of SPD matrices as a Riemannian manifold. The first one is the affine variant matrix, and it's actually a very old. Matrix it has been studied for a very long time, starting by at least as early as 1943. And it has been studied extensively recently. So I'm just listing some of the work here. So this is like a view of the set of the Riemannian matrix. The tangent space is actually the set of symmetric matrix, and this is like the inner product on the tangent space. So the inner product will be symmetric, which is given by trace of P inverse, DP inverse W. So this one is actually kind of a fine variant, so it defines like an affine variant matrix, Riemannian matrix on the manifold. And then what the important thing to know is actually that's a unique, let's say, between any two matrices, SPD matrices A and B, there's a unique geodesic joining them. And many quantities that can be computed explicitly. So the geodesic has an explicit expression is given by this formula here, so starting from A and ending at B. So it has an explicit form, and the geodesic distance can be computed explicitly as well, as given by the forgiveness number love, I mean, when this love here is the principle of reasonable aid. So it can be, so many communities can be computed explicitly. And so this actually, this is something that we can actually use in practice. Now it's a fine invariant, it's a confinement, it's a fine invariant to transform A and B by any equitable matrix C, like C and C, C transpose C, so we have the same length, we have the same distance. And the special case of this is when C is just equal to the scaling matrix, then it's a scale invariant. And also, it's, of course, it's orthogonally invariant because it's a special case of a fine invariant. And it's also invariant under inversion because A and B in the distance remain the same. So so one way to see is actually if we view A and B as the covariance matrix of two Gaussian density, with covariance matrices A and B, then we can actually measure the distance between the Gaussian measures by either the covariance matrix or the position matrices that remain the same. And under this so the manifold is actually geodesically complete. So this metric, the set of SPD matrices under this distance is a complete metric space. All the Gaussian sequences will converge in the space itself. And it has a close correlation with the Fisher-Raman metric in information geometrics. So actually just applies if we have a two Gaussian density with the same mean and governance matrices is C1 and C2, then the distance, the C1 and C2 is like 2 times official distance from the one we go to. So I'm just measuring this like this financial information generation. So in terms of complexity, like we need, if you want to compute like the distance we can do to which is A and B, then we need to compute this. So we need to compute the eigenvalues of this matrix, or if we want to compute the eigenvalues of this like inverse B. So this one requires like matrix inversion in SVD and so on. I think the computation has computational complexity of O and Q. And but one thing that is not so which is not so bad about this distance is that if we have like a set of X and SPD matrices, then we have to compute all the pairwise distances between AI and AJ, then since actually in this formulation AI and AJ are kind of are coupled together, so if we want to compute all the pairwise distances, we have to do kind of SPD and all for all pairs of AI and AJ. So this requires a computational complexity of O n squared and Q. So it actually scales with n squared, where n is the number of matrices. So it can be actually very large when n is large. So so there are many nice things about it. Many things can be computed explicitly. And yes, it has a lot of nice invariances, but at the same time, it's about the computational behavior. So this is one of the motivations really to the log utility of matrix, which was proposed by Sini et al. In 2007. So this is actually another remaining metric on the set of SPD matrices. Sometimes it's also viewed as an approximation of the FI invariant metric, but it's this W is not so respectable. So I'm just talking about it as a remaining metric, which is a lot faster to compute than the FI invariant metric. And it can be used to define many positive definite kernels on the set of SPD matrices. So this is actually it has a pretty complicated Riemannian metric, the expression, but it's actually not, this is given by this expression, but it's not, the knowledge of this expression is actually not necessary for computing the geodesics of the Riemannian distances. So after showing it to show it's actually Riemannian metric. Now it has so under this metric, between any set of points, any two point or two matrices A and B, there's also like a unique geodesic joining them, and it's given by this expression here, so it's actually kind of it's simpler than the expression for the invariant metric, and the geodesic distance between A and B is given by it's called the log of the distance, it's given by just the log of the distance. So it's actually a lot simpler than the invariant distance. So, what is good about this distance is actually, so if we compute the distance between any two matrices A and B, then of course we still have to compute the log and so on. So we still need to compute the SPD, so the computational complexity is still M or Q. Now the difference is actually now A and B are not A and B and we have some M SPD matrices and we have already coupled together. So we can actually carry out the computational log AI OBA for the OIs separately, and you can actually do it at the same time parallel. So the computational complexity is actually n, it's only n and q. So it's actually, it can be like n times faster than you find your distance, and it can be n parallel. So it's like in practice, actually a lot faster. So this is like the advantage. One advantage. So this metric is something we call the bi-invariant Riemannian metric. It's associated with the Lie-Group operation defined by asking error 2007, where normally we have the production to SPD two metrics. If we multiply two metrics together, then they mean, if we have two symmetric metrics, then the product may no longer be symmetric. So we verify this. With the so this one is a commutative matrix multiplication, and it preserves at the set simplest and essentially towards under this operation. And the lovely metric is a bi-invariant Riemannian metric in the sense that we actually is invariant under this this operation. So they also define something, the scalar multiplication operation by this expression here. So when lambda times a is to the exponential, which is a to the power of lambda. So now these two operations together actually make the set of c versus n into a vector space with this order acting as vector addition and then this star here acting as scalar multiplication. So we actually have a very simple, very special vector space structure. So it's actually a vector space. So it's actually a flat, so it's actually is flat. And as a Riemannian manifold, it has zero curvature. But it's not a subspace, so it's not a subspace of Abelian space. As I said before, the set is actually not a subspace of Abelian vector space in the sense that it's not a subspace under the operation of matrix addition and scalar multiplication. It's actually a vector space under these special operations. And it can be endowed with a linear product as well. So the lovely linear product is actually defined by Lie and Rho in 2013. So we define this linear product in a lovely, just equal to the linear product of your lovely. And so this, with this linear product, is the set of SPS, it was added to these two operations, and the lovely linear product becomes a linear product space. And so this, the lovely is an essential linear product distance. So this actually this property is very useful for defining positive definite kernels on the set of SPD matrices. So it's actually so you know it's the vector space. It's flat, but it's actually quite different from the Euclidean distance. So the only thing that they share in common is this kind of the orthogonal invariants, which are both invariants under this the multiplication by C A C inverse where C is an orthogonal matrix. But it's a scale invariant, whereas the Euclidean distance is not scale invariant. And it's inversion invariant. So if you invert A and B, then the distance remains the same, whereas the Euclidean distance is not inversion invariant. And since it's actually an inner product, the distance is an inner product distance, actually, the set of this distance is actually a complete metric space, whereas the Euclidean distance is incomplete. So they're actually quite different. So it's the lovely Euclidean metric is actually restricted to C plus plus n, and so and they have quite different various properties. Okay. Now I can give you
before we're not just on the question.
Yes, please.
So what's the reason that you might want inversion?
So in this particular setting, I might not want it, but I was just setting. I'm just saying that they have very different properties. So before I was saying that sometimes like you want because actually if you have a measure production densities together, then the distance between the covariance matrix and the density like the and the precision matrices are the same. So sometimes if we want to use precision matrices, because we want to use the inversion of time. Because you need to use it for many times, for example, you have to compare it with inversion. Because the precision matrix is the inversion of the covariance matrix. So you want to use it over and over again, you don't want to compare it with inversion. Yeah, but in this setting, I'm actually not using it. I'm just saying that they actually have different vectors. Because actually the people think that they are kind of the two vectors because they both fight. So what is the difference? Okay, I do not have I'm not sure whether we have time to talk about the covariance operators. Okay, so this one is the kind of the log determinant divergences. It arises from using this as the probability category of strictly convex function and the negative number of that is a strictly convex function of the set of SPD matrices. So using this property, we actually have this quality here because essentially this function is strictly convex, so this is always greater than negative to zero, and it's equal to zero when they are the same. And so alpha to negative 1 and 1, and then we have the limit when alpha approaches 1 and alpha approaches negative 1. So this actually can go, this is going to be the divergence. So this actually is pretty commonly used. And in the case when alpha is equal to 0, we have, so it's not symmetric actually, it's not symmetric in general, it's not symmetric. It's only symmetric when alpha is equal to 0. When alpha is equal to 0, we have only the symmetric spine divergence. It's actually very commonly used. So the square root of this divergence is actually a metric. So in general, it's not a metric. So in the case when alpha equals zero, the square root is a metric. So it's like this property is actually pretty hard to prove. But this viewpoint is actually very general. This alpha log determinant divergences can be generalized from the alpha beta divergences, and they include the phi invariant minor distance as a special case. So this viewpoint is actually very general. Anyway. Okay, I assume that you know about positive definite kernels, so we'll talk about. So with the log determinant inner product, we can define polynomial positive definite kernels on SPD matrices. So instead of the inner product of x and y, for the polynomial kernels, we define the inner product of log p and with the log p. So it's a polynomial kernels with using the log term with this inner product. And we can define the Gaussian So the section is about p here, so we're just using the logarithmic distance about p, but p is between 0 and 2. So p, this is actually even only p is between 0 and 2. So we can define, so with this, we can define kernel methods on the logarithmic metric. So there is something global done by the Santos, Gerard, Christian, Kistani in 2013. So this is one example of using the image classification or doing image classification with log determinant matrix. So we have a set of images, we extract all the features, and for each image we can do a covariant matrix analysis on the remaining manifold, then we can compute the log determinant distance. And with the log determinant distance we can actually compute the distance matrix, and we have another kernel of probability distance, we have a Gaussian curve, for example. And then using that, we can compute, we can do something like SD Young classification. Oh, so this is an example here, like a formulae material classification, what features are red, green, and blue, and some purple responses. Okay, and then here to the set. Okay, so I'm just showing some examples here. I'm just showing that you actually got going from the ingredient to the kind of remaining setting, it's actually sort of better. You can actually optimize some question about the results. But this is not the best result, this is just. But that's a very big improvement from going from the just the ingredient to the metric and the ingredient. Okay. Okay, I still have that. I will try to go over this. So the covariance matrices are only they only encode linear correlations of image features. Now to doing now we want to actually create a non-linear version of this. So what we want to do is actually we want to map the original features into a very high dimensional feature space and we compute the covariance matrix in that particular feature space. So then we have a non-linear correlation between the image features. And so this provides a richer expressive representation of the data. So this is done by a kernel. So suppose we have a kernel matrix and we have a positive definite kernel K on X cross X, and HK is the corresponding and decreasing the lymphocytes, increasing the lymphocytes at the HS induced by Getty, then there's like a very powerful new point from machine learning is a feature map and map X into HK. So H, X is mapped into the point PX in the humus base HK. So that like PX and PY, you look at the HK just for the kernel PX. So this is the idea behind the kernelization method in the machine learning. We just transform the linear gradient using the integral X and Y to nonlinear gradients depending on PX, Y. And so what we do is actually, instead of the covariance matrix, we actually want to compute the covariance of because this is the mean vector in Rn. We compute like we have the feature phi, which is map phi, then we can compute like mu phi, which is replaced these by phi. So instead of the expectation of x, which is replaced by the expectation of phi. And the same for the covariance of the covariance matrix. We have the covariance matrix expectation of x minus mu. We compute the expectation of x minus phi x minus mu and phi x minus mu. This was like transpose. So in terms of the empirical representation, we compute instead of the data matrix x, we compute the, this one is actually computed implicitly because it's really implicit. We compute phi x. Data matrix actually phi x, phi x 1, phi x n, and then we can compute the corresponding covariance matrix. So this is like mu of x, we just replace x by phi of x. So these are all implicit because the feature map is implicit. And the same for the covariance matrix of instead of x, j, x transpose, it's equal to phi x, j, x transpose. So these are actually, so this is the empirical version of the theoretical version, theoretical covariance operator. So in this case, if HK is the Gaussian kernel, then the HK is actually infinite dimensional. So this covariance operator is actually an infinite dimensional Riemannian length. So these are, so we represent the HK made by the covariance operator. So the representation is actually implicit and everything is done by the gray matrices. Okay, so it's actually kind of the, it's no longer like a finite dimensional manifold, such an infinite dimensional Riemannian manifold. And so actually the work, the affine Hebbian Riemannian matrix was actually generalized in 2007 by Lalo Tonda, the basic species. And then we have to kind of carry out the work in the EU, something about the HS covariance operators. And we did this in three-dimensional log determinant divergences, and kind of the, we can just class operators and post indefinite dimensional operators. But I'm talking about the log, I'm talking about the kind of the log, the generalization of the log of Euclidean distance, which is called the log of Euclidean, the log inversion image. Okay, I will actually explain the ideas here, because I have time. So the generalization of the end set of SPD matrix that's C versus N is actually is given by this set here. So we have set A plus gamma I, where A is a self-adjoint in the street operator, which is positive definite. We need actually we need this like the gamma I here always. And I will explain why we need this like the A plus gamma. So this is actually this is a manifold. It's not just like A positive definite, it's actually A plus gamma I. I'll explain why we need that. Okay, so let's see how we want to generalize the log Euclidean distance. So here we have the generalization of log A minus log B in the Fourier time is something going to become the log inverse distance. So we have the distance between A plus gamma I, B plus mu I is equal to log of A plus gamma I plus log B. This is something we're going to look at. The extended inverse now is introduced by the log of B. So A is inverse and gamma I is actually I is not inverse of B. Schmidt is the norm of the identity operator in the infinite dimensional setting is actually equal to infinity. So if you just like have the Schmidt norm, it's actually equal to infinity. So we have to do something called the extended Schmidt norm. So this is actually equal to the Schmidt norm of the square of A plus gamma squared. And the same thing for the extended Schmidt norm. So the product of A plus gamma is just minus B plus gamma. So in this setting, basically if A is equal to 0, then the graph of this, the norm of this I is actually equal to 1. So this side is from a compact integration. Instead of setting, instead of having the denominator, the identity will be infinity, you actually set it to be 1. And why, okay, so why we want, like, why we want to call the level of this gamma I, and why we want to expect the Schmidt norm? So, by level of equals gamma I, so look at this place, you know, the C versus N here, so it has like here, a special decomposition here, and we want to compute the log, like, you know, which is compute the log of like I'm here. Now, if we want, like, if we have like infinitely many of these, for something like covariance operator, suppose everything is positive or the eigenvalue is positive, we have infinitely many of them, the eigenvalues will go to 0. So if we, so the log of lambda k, so lambda k goes to 0 and log of lambda k will go to negative infinity. So log of a is always unbounded for positive compact operator. So that's the reason why we need to use log of gamma. So log of a is always unbounded in the infinite dimensional setting. We have to compact the positive operator, so this is a plus gamma I is bounded. So we need to do this always, not because it's a theoretical. Now, if we do this and we use the universal Schmidt norm, then the set, this actually is equal. We have the law of the universal Schmidt norm of this, that will be some measure of order. Gamma k is gamma squared, and when gamma k is 0, this goes to the log of gamma squared. If gamma is not equal to 1, which is not 0, so this is equal to infinity. So really gamma is not equal to 1, so that's the extent. That's the reason for the use of the extended universal Schmidt norm. And, you know, so if we need the extended universal Schmidt norm, it's always fine. So that's basically the use of these. Log of a plus gamma I and the extended dimension now. Okay. See? Now in the case of the, I just want to show you that these, if we have like two covariance operators, so we have these two covariance operators representing two images, CPS, CPY, this is the regularization terms here. So they are defined in terms of the feature matrix is Px and Py. So these, actually, this distance always has a ghost form in terms of the corresponding value, which is what K is defined by this. It's such an N by N matrix, and Kx has a Poisson matrix with Kx, Ix, J. So it has a ghost form. And in the... I'm not going to go through these examples. I'm going to show that actually there are these are the closed form expressions for the Lockean Schmidt distance and inner product. This is the distance, it has a closed form expression. This inner product, it has a closed form expression. So I'm just telling you that it has a closed form. So, but the only thing that I want to mention is actually this is the case where the dimension is equal to infinity. So the dimension HK doesn't appear anywhere here. This is a case where the dimension is equal to, is less than infinity. So the dimension factor actually does appear. And one can actually see that as the dimension goes to infinity, this expression will go to infinity. So the infinite dimensional version cannot be approximated, in general, it cannot be approximated by the parametric dimension by letting the dimension go to infinity. It's the same here for the interactive. So the main difference actually is the dimension factor. So now, we can actually compute like the Gaussian, we can compute the polynomial kernels in the same way as with the locability and distance, and you know, we can define the polynomial kernels here, and we can define the Gaussian kernel as well. It's basically in the same way. So everything here has a closed form and a computable form. So if we do that, then we have something called a two-layer kernel machine for the locability matrix. So the first layer, we have the kernel K1. This induces a covariance operator. Kernel K2, you can define like the log Hilbert Schmidt distance between the covariance operators, and you can define the kernel on top of this. So we have, this is a two-layer kernel machine for some image classification. So we have certain images here, some new features. Using the we have the kernel K1. So this actually, this is implicitly a mapping key, and then the covariance operator. So these are all implicit. It's all implicit. You can compute the, and then we can compute the log in the Schmidt distance using the covariance operators. So we have a distance matrix. We define another function kind of kernel on top of this. So we have two kernels. So before, for the probably lock the updated system to step at one layer. And then we can define another, we can define the SVM and any kind of properties. So before, okay. So we can see, so this is like the comparison coming from the finite dimensional to the three-dimensional setting. And so this is just using the radial distance, using like the normal radial. And this is using the Hilbert-Schmidt distance. So the Hilbert-Schmidt distance is actually just basically just the radial distance to the three-dimensional setting. So it has to take into account and you can also get definitions of the covariance and matrices. And you should do the Hilbert-Schmidt distance. I'm actually having kind of live here from the CNN features, so actually can be applied to the CNN features as well. So it actually has a like a very high performance the covariance using the CNN features. And so these the method I described is actually computationally heavy because I think you can see from the expression of the this is really heavy to compute because you have to compute. You have all kinds of metric system, you have to compute with branches and so on, so it's actually really heavy. So we have also done like approximate methods as well. And this is like one example of the object recognition example to approximate distance. So anyway, what I have shown you about sorry for the very fast talk, but I was telling you about the covariance matrix, the covariance operators, the covariance division, and from what you take, you see this materials. Yeah, we have to look here. Thank you for listening. I'm open for questions.
Okay, I'm temporarily replacing Alessandra as chairman. So are there questions, comments, remarks?
It did go by a bit fast.
I don't know what I said.
So from the perspective of quantum machine learning and quantum mechanics, so one of the main things that quantum computers buy you is they can do linear algebra operations like inverting matrices, taking traces, exponentially faster than classical systems. And maybe this is a comment for the quantum computing people. So those covariance matrices and kernels can be written as either as density matrices. So the covariance matrix is actually transcendent quantum mechanics. It's the density matrix for your data. And kernel is a complementary matrix, which can also typically be produced graphically on a quantum computer. Consequently, they can be diagonalized and their eigenvalues estimated in time, order polylogarithmic of the dimension of the space. And so I do have a couple of comments on the different kinds of distances there. So one thing which is, and this really is leading to a question, sorry about the extended comment here. So all of the metrics for covariance matrices that you mentioned, including the affine invariant Riemannian metric, can be estimated in the amount of time that goes as on polylogarithmic in the dimension of the space. I guess you said, did I get this right? That you said the difficulty in evaluating this affine invariant Riemannian metric, it seems like the most natural metric in some sense.
Right.
Because you have to take these matrix inverses and square roots, it's hard to do.
It's about because actually the expression here we have like the kind of if we have a large set of matrices, then they are kind of coupled together, actually. So if you want to do, let me go over there, too.
Yeah, could you show that slide with the scaling area? It went by a little rapidly. Too fast, we actually could write that.
This one, they are, because actually they're kind of coupled together. So if we have a set of matrices, like for example, we have to do it like for every pair. So like the main difference compared to the logarithmic is actually
we have square, capital N square. Yeah.
Right. So then we have the N square, where N is the number of matrices. So that is the main difference because in the case of the logarithmic, like these two things are kind of uncoupled, so we don't have to do it there by there.
Okay. So anyway, I guess then my comment is that that at least in the context of quantum machine learning, both of these kernel methods and for these different types of distances, that there's a potential for a significant speed up because all of these distances can be evaluated exponentially faster from a quantum computer.
That would be great. I saw your quantum machine.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty sure. I have to check this, but the little n becomes little n cubed becomes log n squared. And I don't know about this capital N squared. Maybe that also becomes kind of polylogic capital N, but I'm not sure.
Okay. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.